me, bless me, bless me, God in me. Death has been defeated, here's a victory. Bless me, bless me, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything they need. Let all these folks that's in me, God, have everything they need. Bless me, bless me, bless me, God in me. Death has been defeated, here's a victory. Bless me, bless me, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything they need.
True story. There was a pastor, he's in the States, and when he was young, he learned everything there was to learn about lying from his older brother. There was a time when his older brother came along and asked his mum, said, "Mum, can I buy a car?" He was senior high school by now. She goes, "No way, son." Off he goes. Anyway, he went and bought a car behind his mother's back. And he was delighted with this car. It's an awesome little car. But what does he do now? He can't park it out the front. His mum will say, "You can't park it in the garage." His mum and dad will know. So he parks it around the corner of the block. And so it comes time to go to school in the morning, and the young bloke and his older brother, they walk up around the block as if they're going to school, jump in the car, drive to school instead of walking, go to school, drive back, park it around the block, and then they walk home again. "Hey, mum. Oh, how's your day, kids?" "Oh, it was awesome, thanks." Yeah. And this went on for quite a while, and it was working really well. But then sometimes it would rain, wouldn't it? And so mum would say to the older brother, oh gee, it's, you know, instead of walking in the rain, here, take my car, take the family car today. So she'd give the keys to the older brother. He said, "Oh, thanks, mum." They'd jump in the car, drive around the corner, park the car. He would jump out of the family car into his own car and give the keys to his 13-year-old younger brother, and they would both drive to school. 13-year-old driving the family car to school. Imagine the prestige he'd have with all of his mates. Anyway, school would finish, they drive back, park both cars around the corner so mum couldn't see. He'd shuffle across, big brother would jump in the driver's seat, they'd drive home. "Oh gee, thanks mum for letting us borrow your car today, that was awesome." Until one day, they drive to school, they walk around the corner, jump in the car, drive to school, and then just towards the end of the day, it begins to rain, doesn't it? So mum's at home, you know, kind, compassionate mum. "Oh gee, I've got to let the boys walk in the rain." So she starts to drive to school. In the meantime, the boys have jumped in his car, driving along, and suddenly, younger one goes, "I think that's mum." The big brother goes, "Oh no, it is, quick, duck." And they're driving along with their heads down until they think mum's gone past. And they're, "Ah, no, quick!" Race around the block, park at the back of the school, run through the school and out the front door, down the stairs, and out to the gate, pretend they're gonna walk home. And then, beep, beep! Oh, mum! "Hey, mum! Oh, boys, it's raining. You wanna jump in? I'll give you a lift home." And so they jump in and they drive home. See, I tell this story because we're looking at honesty. Does this work? Which button do I press? Do I have to turn it on? Ah. I'm good at technology. That's not being honest. There we go. So what is this thing, honesty? Obviously, thinking about that story I just told, you can probably pick holes in all of the parts of that where dishonesty was occurring. Well, in a nutshell, honesty means that you're telling the truth. Okay, you're being truthful. Well, what's that? Well, being truthful is saying or showing what happens in the real world based on facts, not on imagination. If you ask a child what it means to be honest, they most likely will tell you, oh, don't tell a lie. And you see, that's actually true. That's part of being honest. But being honest is more than simply not telling a lie. You see, Francis' older brother didn't tell a lie to their mum. He didn't say, hey mum, guess what? I didn't buy a car today. But because being honest is not just about what you say, it's also about your actions. And his actions in that situation certainly were not being honest. And if you have to hide what you're doing, like hiding your car around the corner of the block because you're trying to trick someone, then you are definitely not being honest. There's several elements of honesty. The first one is simply telling the truth. Okay, so telling the truth based on what actually happened, based on facts, based on real things. Saying things that aren't true, or that you think might not be true, or that you're making up to hide the truth, are all types of lies. Now, lying is not honest, that's why they call it being dishonest, because you're saying something that isn't true. You're not being honest if you make up rumors about someone, or if you share rumors about someone that someone else made up. Being honest means that you admit to your actions, even if you know that you're going to get in trouble. You're not being honest if you deny that you did something wrong, but the reality is that you did it. Honesty means that you explain how a situation really happened. You're not being honest if you say something happened one way, when the reality is that it happened another way. So what comes out of your mouth? But also, another element of honesty is not hiding the truth. In other words, you tell the whole truth. So what you say might not have been dishonest in itself, but what you didn't say can sometimes, make it look like the truth was something else than what it really was. So not hiding the truth. Because if you hide the truth, then you're being deceitful and you're tricking other people. And that likewise is dishonest. And a third way, as we spoke about before, is acting truthfully. Not doing things that involve tricking or hurting other people for your own benefit. For example, buying a car, not telling mum, but still enjoying the benefits of that. Okay, the actions are not truthful in that situation. When you do something that you know is morally wrong, when you have to hide your actions because you know they are wrong, you're not being honest. Being honest means that you act in a way that you know is the right thing to do. This part of the definition of honesty includes not hiding the truth, i.e. being deceiving, not breaking rules to gain an advantage, i.e. cheating, and not taking something that isn't yours, stealing, and any other action that you would hide because it is against what you consider to be morally right. I know this from personal experience. There was a time in my first marriage where little things started to creep in. And these things I knew were not right. But I would just start to hide these things, and eventually got to the point where simply hiding my actions couldn't be done without little lies starting to creep in. And the funny thing is, once you start to tell little lies, and we'll expand on this more later, those little lies pretty soon have to become big lies. But then you forget what lies you've told before. And so eventually, it's like getting stuck in a spider web. You're going to get trapped by your own deceit and by your own lies. You will be exposed as a fraud, as I was, and your world potentially could come crashing down around, as my first marriage did. Now, we've got a few slides here. Now, by the way, these slides here I have borrowed from my primary school curriculum, but they illustrate the point very well. So, we have a little child here eating a cookie. The question is asked, who ate the cookies? Oh, I don't know. Being honest means that you tell the truth. Saying something that is not true is lying. Clearly, in that situation, the child knew they ate the cookie. Knocking something over and breaking it. I didn't do it, brother or sister did. How many times have you seen that in your household? So being honest means that you say what really happened. Saying things happen differently is being dishonest. Ooh, something there that you really want. Temptation is that you want to take it and run out the door with it. Acting honestly means that you don't trick or harm others for your benefit. Stealing is dishonest. Send your kids to bed. You trust that they're going to go to sleep. Hiding underneath the blankets with a torch, reading or playing on their phone or whatever. Are you sleeping? Being honest means that you're truthful in your actions. Hiding actions you know are wrong is dishonest. Now there's another element of honesty, and this is the one that I want us to focus on. You see, we all know that honesty is what you say and how you act towards others, but another part of the definition of honesty is, are you honest with yourself? See, being honest with yourself means that you really know why you are acting in a certain way, or whether what you tell yourself is true. And this part of the definition of honesty includes when you're trying to convince yourself that you didn't do something wrong. You justify your actions or say it wasn't that bad, even though you know it was. You see, this was my issue. See, I was justifying what I was doing in my first marriage because of the circumstances that were going on around at that time. Oh no, it's not that bad. Oh, I'm justified in this because she did that. But what does the Bible have to say about that? Luke 16:10 says, "One who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much. And one who is dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much." Because the way that you respond in those small little circumstances is also going to be true of the way you're going to be respond when there is much greater weight of responsibility on that. And the reason for that is, find my spot in here, that your attitude in the small things and your moral choices in the small things comes from the same place as your attitude and choices for the big things. How do we know this? Matthew chapter 15 tells us, "But the words you speak come from the heart. For from the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, all sexual immorality, theft, lying, slander. These are what defile you." So your character doesn't change depending upon how serious you think that situation is. If you think it's a little small white lie, it's still a lie, as opposed to a great big blatant obvious thing. But you go, yeah, okay, I know all of that. I know about honesty, I know what's good, I know what's wrong. Okay, I know what it is to tell a lie. I know what it means to cheat on a test. You know, in my day, you'd write little notes on your hand, in your pocket, or scratch it up on a piece of paper up underneath the table. These days they've got laptops and stuff, they probably don't do that anymore. Okay, we know what it means to cheat on our taxes. My son was telling me just the other day, someone was explaining to him how, oh, you can claim up to this much on this and that, before you have to show any evidence, actually prove that you did those things or that you bought those things. You can claim this much for free. No one will know. We know what it means to cheat on our spouse. And I'm not just talking about infidelity. Okay, you know, cheating on time, cheating on emotional connection, lots of different ways you can cheat on your spouse. We know what it means to be cheating on our learner's logbook. Do we have any learners in here? My daughter was telling me that half of her friends at school, they probably haven't done 50% of what's in their logbook that their parents have signed off on. We know about the fear of getting caught when we've done something wrong, don't we? You know, heart rate goes up, our skin gets all prickly. We know how juicy gossip is. We know how to fake that smile, especially on a Sunday morning when we walk in the door and people go, "Hey, how are you?" "Yeah, I'm great." Really? I know we don't want to spill our guts the moment somebody talks to us, but are we being honest? You see, we know so much about it. Surely we've got this one under control. Surely we don't need to hear another sermon on it. Turn with me, if you can, please, to Matthew chapter 19. If you have your good books here or your technology. Matthew chapter 19 and verse 16. Someone came to Jesus with this question: "Teacher, what good deed must I do to enter eternal life?" "Why ask me about what is good?" Jesus replied. "There is only one who is good. But to answer your question, if you want to receive eternal life, keep the commandments." The guy's eyes light up. Bing! He goes, "Which ones?" Jesus goes, "Well, don't murder anyone. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't testify falsely." In other words, don't lie. "Honor your father and mother. Love your neighbor as yourself." And he goes, "Awesome. I've done all of these. What else should I do?" Thinking, "Oh yeah, there'll be a few more things I can tick off." And Jesus told him, "If you want to be perfect, go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." But when the young man heard this, he went away sad, for he had many possessions. You see, the rich man ticked all the boxes. You know, he had it made. All his life he'd been trained up in the ways of honesty and righteousness, and for all intents and purposes, it looked like on the outside that he was doing a pretty darn good job of it too. But when Jesus looked at him, he saw beyond the outer shell, right into the man's heart. Then he demanded of him something that was going to cost him a great deal. And verse 22 tells us, "Then he went away sad, for he had many possessions." And the reason I tell this story today, or read this story, is because, you see, education and learning and knowing about it isn't necessarily going to bring the lasting, life-changing transformation that Christ wants for us in our hearts. Yes, we definitely need to study the Word. It's not a cop-out saying, "Oh, that means I don't have to read the Bible." Wrong. We need to be in the Word every single day. It's vital. But many people go to seminary or Bible college to study, only to fall away from their faith a few short years later. See, they also walk away sad and disgruntled. Why? Well, perhaps it's possible that Christ demanded of them something equally difficult as he demanded of the rich young ruler. Perhaps they had many possessions stored up, maybe in their material world, but maybe on their spiritual trophy shelf that they simply couldn't let go of. Either way, when we're focusing on an external display of certain moral, upright, honest behaviors, we simply will never meet the standards that Christ demands of us. How do I know this? Well, let's look at Matthew chapter 5. And in verse 20, he says to us, "But I warn you, unless your righteousness is better than the righteousness of the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. What? Really? I mean, these guys were the top notch of religiousness and holiness and uprightness. And you're telling me that unless I'm better than them, that's not possible. What about the next verse? You have heard that our ancestors were told, you must not murder. But I say, if you are even angry with someone, you are subject to judgment. And if you curse someone, you're in danger of the fires of hell. What? But I didn't even do anything. I just felt angry in my heart. Verse 27, you have heard it said, you must not commit adultery. But I say, anyone who even looks at a woman inappropriately has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Ouch! Fellas, I think there's not a man alive who can say that's never happened to them. I was listening to something recently, and apparently the book of Job is one of the most ancient manuscripts that was written. And even in Job, way back in the day, you know the verse where he says, I have made a covenant with my eyes not to look at lust at a younger woman. So this is not something new, fellas. You're not the first one to go through this. The devil knows how we tick, and right from the very beginning of time, this is something that we need to guard our eyes and our hearts from. Verse 43, it goes on again, there's more. You have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. If you love only those who love you, what reward is there for that? Because even the corrupt tax collectors do that much. If you're kind only to your friends, how are you different from anyone else? Even pagans do that. But you and me, you are to be perfect. Let that statement sink in. You are to be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Say what? You can't be serious. No one can be perfect. Jesus can't possibly expect that of me. I am, after all, just a man, you know, a sinner, just forgiven, not perfect. I even had the sticker when I was at university. Was it Christians are not perfect, just forgiven? So how can Jesus expect me to be perfect? Someone call the ambulance. I think I want to walk away sad. But here's the point. Maybe the possessions that Jesus is asking us to give up for him are not in the form of material wealth. You know, the rich young ruler, he had lots of material wealth, but he also had lots of spiritual trophies. And maybe we also have worldly attitudes and pleasures that we like. They comfort us. And they're not inherently wrong. They're not sinful in and of themselves. But if they're getting in the way of our intimacy with Jesus Christ, then we need to let them go. The issue with the rich young ruler was not his wealth, not his money, not even his worldly passion, because he probably worked really hard to earn what he had. And we should be able to enjoy the fruits of our labors. That's all good. The issue with the rich young ruler was the condition of his heart. Jesus was testing the loyalty of his heart. Does he love God more than his earthly riches? Is he willing to give up everything to follow God? And sadly, this young man just couldn't let it go. His actions were the true reflection of his heart, that he loved money and worldly possessions more than he loved God. Verse 14 says that you are the light of the world. This is still Matthew chapter 5, by the way, commonly known as the Sermon on the Mount. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp, then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. Now, hang on a minute there, preacher. You know, at first you say the good deeds simply don't cut it. You know, as hard as we try, we're not going to be able to attain to Jesus' standards. You know, you say we have to be perfect, just like Jesus, but now you're saying we have to do more good deeds. Yes. But did you see the motivation behind the good deeds? So that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. How often do we do good stuff? Because we want someone to pat us on the back. Because we want to polish our own halo. Because we want the accolades. Because it feels good when everyone's, oh wow, you're such a kind, generous, helpful, loving person. How often do we do stuff for us? Oh, it's the word for the Lord, but it's for us. But this is saying an attitude needs to be so that everyone will praise your Heavenly Father. Back in my first marriage, I didn't quite understand a lot of stuff. And I thought when you came into a marriage, there's husband and wife. 50-50 equals 100. And I thought that, well, if I gave 50 and she gives 50, it's all good. Then everything will be happy, you know. Everything will balance out on the seesaw and we'll all be good. But you see, the problem with that is the attitude behind it. Because the problem with that is you've got a line drawn there. And you're prepared to do all your bit up to that, but then you're not prepared to step over that line and go that extra mile. You're not prepared to sacrifice. You're thinking of your rights. Oh, well, I did the washing last time, it's your turn now. You know, well, do I really have to pick up your dirty socks and put them in the laundry hamper? So you think that 50-50 balances out, but it ends up in anger, frustration, resentment, bitterness, finger pointing. And ultimately, it ended up in the destruction of my marriage. Because I was so self-righteous and hung up with my rights that it just didn't work. No, we have to lay ourselves down 100% and not expect anything in return. But the amazing thing is that when we're prepared to sacrifice ourselves for someone else in that way, their attitude changes as well. And they just find themselves overwhelmed with the desire to want to lay themselves down on our behalf as well. And this is just even in a human relationship. It works amazingly. It's like counterintuitive, but God designed it that way. And you see, when we stop worrying about, oh, that's not fair, oh, I deserve this, oh, my rights that, then it stirs something within their heart, the heart of the receiver, and it multiplies the return exponentially. But you know, in the same way, we need to lay ourselves down 100% for Christ. 100%. Give up all of our rights, and then watch and see that the God who knows how to give good gifts, just how He will move and work in our circumstances. And that is what Jesus is asking us to do in Matthew chapter 5. And if you're living the honest life that we're called to live, it is going to cost us something at some point. We are going to have to sacrifice. If not, well then we're no different to anyone else on the planet. You know, we're supposed to let our good deeds shine, draw people to Jesus. But this kind of honesty and integrity is radical. It's supernatural. It's not normal. And we can't do it in our own strength. Those who have tried have walked away sad. But I say, don't be sad. Get excited because the Holy Spirit wants to take you to the next level of radical obedience, of radical sacrifice for our Lord, and behavior that actually draws people to the King himself. I read a lot of a guy called Oswald Chambers. If you've never read him, please read him. And recently I was reading his thoughts on this chapter, chapter 5 of Matthew, which is the Sermon on the Mount. And this is what he said. He said, "Beware of thinking of our Lord only as a teacher. If Jesus Christ is only a teacher, then all he can do is frustrate me by setting a standard before me that I cannot attain." You might be thinking that at the moment after what I've just said. "What is the point of presenting me with such a lofty ideal that I cannot possibly even come close to reaching it? I would be happier if I never knew it. What good is there in telling me to be what I can never be? To be pure in heart, to be perfect, to do more than my duty, to be completely devoted to God. You see, I must know Jesus Christ as my Savior before his teaching has any meaning for me other than that of a lofty ideal which only leads to despair. But when I am born again by the Spirit of God, I know that Jesus Christ did not only come to teach, but he came to make me, to transform me into what he teaches that I should be. See, the redemption means that Jesus Christ can place within anyone the same nature that ruled his own life." Do you hear that? The redemption means that Jesus Christ can place within anyone, that's you, all of you, and me, the same nature that ruled his own life and all of the standards God gives us, like those we just read in Matthew chapter 5, are based on that nature. See, the teaching of the Sermon on the Mount produces a sense of despair in the natural man. Exactly what Jesus meant it to do. As long as we have some self-righteous idea that we can carry out our Lord's teaching, God will allow us to continue with this foolish thought until we expose our own ignorance by stumbling over some obstacle in our way. Only then will we come to him as paupers and receive from him. You see, in verse 3, he says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." And the underlying foundation of Jesus Christ's kingdom is poverty, not possessions, which is counter to what the world teaches us. And see, this is also the lesson that he was trying to teach the rich young ruler. He was rich in possessions, both physically, but also spiritually. He prided himself on how he had kept all the commandments. You see, I bet on his trophy shelf, he right at the top were 10 trophies. One each for the 10 commandments. Because he was the best at keeping them of everyone. And Jesus knew that. He knew that there was pride in the heart of this man, pride in what he had been able to do. But you see, we need to have such a sense of absolute futility that we finally admit, "Lord, I cannot even begin to do it." And then Jesus says, "Blessed are you." This is the doorway to the kingdom. The knowledge of our own poverty is what brings us to the proper place when Jesus Christ accomplishes his work. Verse 3 says, "Blessed are those who are poor in spirit and realize their need for him." See, sometimes as Christians, we think that we're good. We think that our deeds are good. We think we've got it made. Yeah, oh, I don't murder people. I don't steal. I don't lie. I don't commit adultery. I don't lust after women. I'm pretty good. And we think we can make it in our own strength, but Jesus says, no, that's prideful. You see, we require a level of honesty that not all Christians possess. And that is the honesty with the depravity of our own heart. When we look in the mirror, what do we see? Do we see a good Christian? Or do we need see someone who desperately, desperately needs the work of the Holy Spirit? We need to be constantly praying for the Holy Spirit to grant us such humility. You see, in that early part of chapter 5, it says, blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who are humble. Blessed are those whose hearts are pure. But there's good news. You're probably thinking, oh, it's beating up on us a bit this morning. There's good news. Sanctification. Whoa, that's a big word, isn't it? That sounds a bit religious. But it means nothing less than the holiness of Jesus becoming mine and being exhibited in my life. The most wonderful secret of living a holy life does not lie in imitating Jesus, but in allowing the perfect qualities of Jesus to exhibit themselves in my human flesh. Sanctification is Christ in you. It is the impartation of the holy qualities of Jesus Christ to me. It is the gift of his patience. Sometimes I need more of that when I'm driving. It is the gift of his love. And this one really convicts me. Do I actually love people the way Jesus loves people? Do I love my work colleagues enough to tell them about Jesus? That if they don't surrender their life to him, they're going to hell? Do I love the way Jesus loves? I've got a lot to go, a long way to go in that area. It is the gift of his holiness, of his faith. It is the gift of his purity and his godliness. It's not drawing from Jesus the power to be holy. It is drawing from Jesus the very holiness that was exhibited in him and that he now exhibits in me. See, sanctification is an impartation, not an imitation. The perfection of everything is in Jesus Christ. And the mystery of sanctification is that all the perfect qualities of Jesus are at my disposal. Do you believe that? You know, all the perfect qualities of Jesus are at my disposal. So when he says to us, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect, it's not a slap on the face saying, ha ha, I'm going to kick you when you're down. He's saying, no, I want to sanctify you so you can have my holiness, so you can have my qualities and display them in your life. And so consequently, I slowly but surely begin to live a life, my loves, of inexpressible order and soundness and holiness. Do you feel that working in your life? Do you feel over time that as you've allowed the Holy Spirit in, that your life is starting to reflect inexpressible order? Inexpressible soundness and inexpressible holiness? Yeah, we've still got a long way to go. But do you feel the work of the Holy Spirit? If not, maybe you're still hanging on to your trophies. Maybe you're still hanging on to worldly things. Maybe you're not wanting to let go of those things that Jesus is asking you to let go of. And often they're things that nobody else knows about. The things that nobody else sees. Have you ever had somebody with the gall to come up and challenge you on some aspect of your character or your behavior? Has anyone ever done that to you? Like, how do you feel when someone challenges you on the way that you're living your life? How dare they do that? You get like, you know, you think that, then you go back and you go, how dare they? Who do they? they think they are to talk to me like that?
Oh, I know what they've been up to.
How dare they point the finger at me? And anyway, they don't know the reason I did that. I did it because blah, blah, blah. And we justify ourselves. But you know, maybe later, you come home, you calm down a bit, have a coffee, maybe even pray about it. And eventually you realize that, I'm actually right. I actually am arrogant and prideful. I had a guy tell me once, this was after my first marriage had ended and collapsed and fallen in a heap. I wish he had told me this earlier. But he comes up and he says, yeah, because his house was right next to mine, it was higher than mine, and he looked down and he obviously could hear the things that were coming out of my mouth. He could see my behavior, he could see my anger. I was a very angry man, very prideful. But he knew I went to church, and I'd bring my best smile to church. Nobody knew what was going on the inside and behind the four walls of our house. And he said, yep, I'd look at you and I'd just say in my heart, that man needs Jesus. That man needs Jesus. And I thought I had him. And I wish he had said something sooner, before my life went down that path that it did. I might not have liked it. I might have wanted to punch him in the face for it. But you know what? It might have changed the course of the path that I was going down. But you know, when someone does challenge us like that, and I hope you've got people in your life who love you enough to be able to do that, you know, don't get upset about it. Because this is just Jesus asking us to get rid of some of those possessions that we've been holding on to. So rather than walking away sad or mad, get a smile on your face and rejoice that Jesus loves you enough to discipline you and is continuing to transform you, and allow his very nature in, so that when the light of your good deeds shines on those around you, your colleagues, your family, your friends, they'll be amazed, not to praise you and polish your halo, because they will see that it's supernatural. They'll see that it's not an ordinary act, it's not an ordinary attitude, it's not an ordinary behavior. It's way beyond that. It couldn't possibly just be you. There must be something more to you. What's going on in your life? And they will start to praise the King of Kings, the Lord of Heaven's armies. I came across a funny little verse. I'm going to end with this one. It's a proverb, and it's about honesty. See if anyone knows how it ends. I just think it's cute. Put the whole thing up. He's only supposed to put the first part up. But I think it's funny. Whoever gives an honest answer kisses the lips. You see, when you kiss your spouse or your boyfriend or girlfriend, like, it's an act of love and tenderness. And so when we're honest with people, that's what we're bringing to them. When we're honest with ourselves, it's showing that, well, actually, we love ourselves enough to be brutal with ourselves sometimes. So I hope today that it was a bit heavy, but I hope that as you go away encouraged. You know, it's not a lost cause. He doesn't put us out there and let us hang up and be dried, or whatever the expression is. Does anyone know how that one goes? He doesn't just leave us to try and work it out all by ourselves. You know, he gives us his own very nature, that we can be transformed and become the honest people, the people of integrity, the people whose very life shines on all those around us and draws people to himself. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you that you love us so much. We can't even begin to understand how much you love us. And so when we read stuff like this, that we begin to despair in our own human nature. We go, but I can't, but I just can't do it. That's because you want to do it for us. That's because you want to bring us to that point where we
have a light that shines so brightly on those around us, but that it shines the spotlight on you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So I pray for each and every person here this morning that as we go out today, Lord, that yes, we will be people of honesty and integrity, but that we won't be doing it for our own trophies, that we won't be doing it to polish our own halo, but that we will be doing it to glorify your name, that other people will be drawn to you. So go before us, I pray, and just impart your blessings upon us in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen.